Preface and Chapter 1 of The Cycle Industry, Its Origins, History and Latest Developments by W. F. Grew. Preface. The manufacture of bicycles can truly be described as one of the most important industries of the country. The bicycle is also a common commodity, and it is for these two reasons that this book was undertaken. An attempt has been made in the following pages to give a brief outline of the history of the manufacture of bicycles in this and other countries, from the introduction of the velocipede to the present-day mechanically propelled machine, the motorcycle. The author has endeavoured to describe some of the more important processes of manufacture and to embody with those descriptions particulars of the numerous other trades on which the cycle manufacturer is dependent. In conclusion, the writer would like to thank those who have so kindly provided him with illustrations of the machines they make. His thanks are also due to Messrs. Bell and Sons for their kind permission to reproduce illustrations of bygone models from the late Mr. H. Hewitt Griffin's book, Cycling. At the same time, he wishes to make the fullest acknowledgements to all who have in any way assisted him with information in any form. W.F.G. Chapter 1. Early History and Origin of the Bicycle. In this introductory chapter, it is not proposed to deal with the forerunners of the bicycle, such as the hobby horse and some of the more weird wooden machines with four wheels and lever motion, which were known to be in existence before the introduction into this country of the bicycle propelled by cranks attached to the axle of the front wheel, called a velocipede. We will therefore begin with the velocipede, a type of machine which first attracted the attention of a Mr. Turner, who saw it being ridden and exploited at a Paris school of gymnastics. At this period in the history of bicycles, about 1868, the city of Coventry had established, by the enterprise of a few Coventry gentlemen, a factory for the production of sewing machines. The firm was known as the Coventry Sewing Machine Company, afterwards the Coventry Machinist Company, and was founded to find employment for people in the city who had been thrown out of work by the fierce competition of the foreign ribbons and watches which were admitted into the country, either free of duty or on conditions which left very little profit for Coventry ribbon and watchmakers. Mr. Turner, who was an agent for the firm, had been asked to look out for something in the mechanical line, suitable for manufacture at the sewing machine factory, and having been much impressed by the novelty and possibilities of the new velocipede, immediately secured a sample of the machine and brought or sent it to Coventry. The directors and managers of the concern there, after a trial of the bone shaker sent over from Paris, decided to begin manufacturing and marketing the machine, and a dozen or so were put in hand at their workshops and proved a success. This bicycle was made with a cast-iron frame. The felloes and spokes of the wheels were of hickory, with steel tyres, and the saddle was a wooden one covered with leather, thinly padded, and supported on a long flat spring of steel. The bearings were plain journals, that is, in place of steel ball bearings, the axles of the wheels were of steel, and they turned in chilled cast-iron holes in the ends of the forks. The pedals were called treadles, and were mostly of wood. A machine of this description, ready for the road, was sold in London for about £12, without accessories such as lamp, pocket oil can, shifting spanner, leather tool bag, and brake cord, which cost about 25 shillings more. The success of this machine, made by the Coventry Machinist Company, laid the foundation of the trade in Coventry, and it was not very long before quite a considerable business was done by the pioneer firm, and they found it necessary to import into the city mechanics who were more used to the running of heavier machinery than their first employees, engaged in the making of sewing machines. Many of these men came from a firm of ship's engine makers, Penns of Greenwich, now merged with other concerns. Among them were such well-known names as George Singer, James Starley, W. Hillman, etc. T. Bayliss and J. Thomas were pioneers in the trade. The former was a Birmingham gunmaker, the latter came from a cutlery shop at Banbury. Gradually these people started workshops of their own, and with local capital and their own savings embarked themselves as manufacturers of bicycles. Matters progressed rapidly, and like all new trades, it attracted other mechanics and engineers to the city of Coventry. Names such as Haynes and Jeffries, Rudge, Warman, Laxon, Hazelwood, George Townend, Hosier, Hillman, Harrington, etc. are all associated with the early days of bicycle manufacture. In other towns, Parr at Leicester, Robinson and Price at Liverpool, etc., were gaining a reputation. Gradually, the design of the bone shaker was improved. Wrought iron frames followed the cast ones, bearings were made adjustable, rims were covered with rubber instead of steel, the early rubber tyres were flat and secured to the felloe by nails, and steel spokes followed the wooden ones. The great drawback to the bone shaker was its weight, and makers were constantly endeavouring to lighten their productions. Naturally, the saving of weight that first occurred to these pioneers was to make the parts hollow. Many keen practical minds were at work, and one part after another was reduced in weight until there were few parts of the machine that were not made either of hollow steel tube or stamped hollow. Even spokes were tried of thin steel tube before the introduction of the suspension or wire wheel. The backbone of the bicycle, which was evolved from the bone shaker, was of steel tube, at first of flat steel folded and brazed, and lastly drawn out from a solid steel block without a join, or weldless, as it is termed. The fork sides, or blades of the fork, the part in which the wheels revolved, and which were used to connect the wheels to the backbone on which the rider sat and propelled the machine, were made hollow in the same manner. The wheels were at first copies of a light handcart wheel. The wood spokes were brought together by tapering the spoke ends and wedging them together at the nave or hub, and inserting the other ends in the slots in the felloe or wood rim. The whole was surrounded with a flat steel tyre, shrunk on by heating the rim, dropping it over the felloe, and when it cooled it shrank and compressed the parts together. That is the principle of the compression wheel, and is used for all wood-wheeled carts and vans today. The cycle makers, in their search for lightness, first made similar compression wheels, with hollow steel spokes screwed into iron naves and rims. Then came the suspension wheel, which had all the spokes in tension instead of compression. These were first constructed by heading the spokes, threading them through a steel felloe or rim, and inserting them into screwed nipples, which were in their turn screwed into the flanges of the hub. Subsequently, the spokes were screwed direct into the hub, and tensioned by turning the spoke itself and not the nipples. Mention also must be made of the lever construction of Haynes and Jeffries, the precursors of the Rudge firm. This was an arrangement that tensioned the wheel by pulling a lever attached to the spokes so that they were strained in a direction tangential to their hub, and held tight by locking the lever. Following the methods already described, the laced and tangent spoked wheels were introduced. This type of wheel is the modern one that has survived all the others, and reverses the process employed for straight spoked wheels in tension. The flanges of the hub are drilled at right angles. The headed spokes are bent close to the head and threaded through the holes made in the hub flange. The rim ends of the spokes are screwed and inserted in brass or gunmetal nipples, which are passed through holes in the rim from the top or outside, and have heads which prevent the tension on the spoke from pulling them through the rim. Washers are also placed under the heads and fitted in the bed of the rim, to strengthen the rim at the points where this tension strain occurs. Having now outlined the design of the wheels from bone shaker days to the present time, a task which was necessary to enable other items in the process of evolution to be clearly understood, we can return to the machine itself. The tendency, in the main, from the early days to the zenith of glory attained by the high bicycle, or ordinary, as it was latterly termed to distinguish it from other types which were introduced, was to increase the size of the front-driven wheel and reduce the size of the trailing wheel. In the earliest models of 1868-70, the driven wheel was always the larger, but gradually the diameters of the two wheels became estranged until a driven wheel of 60 inches was followed by a trailing wheel of 18 inches. There was only one reason why the large wheel stopped growing, and that was because the length of the rider's limb defined the size of the wheel he could bestride. It will therefore be almost unnecessary to explain that the further a rider was split up, or the longer his legs, the greater advantage he had over men of lesser stature who could only straddle a 52-inch wheel, which was the average size of high bicycle used in the late 80s. Tall men were almost always successful on the racetrack, although lightning pedalers sometimes made up in activity for what they lost in stature. In other words, those of a well-known bookie of the period, "I'd back a good big un against a good little un on a hordinary." The objections to the high bicycle were many, and among its chief drawbacks were that owing to the disparity in wheel diameters and the small weight of the backbone and trailing wheel, also to the rider's position practically over the centre of the wheel, if the large front wheel hit a brick or large stone on the road and the rider was unprepared, the sudden check to the wheel usually threw him over the handlebar. For this reason, the machine was regarded as dangerous, and however enthusiastic one may have been about the ordinary, and I was an enthusiastic rider of it once, there is no denying that it was only possible for comparatively young and athletic men, and if it had remained the only bicycle obtainable, the pastime and the utility of cycling would never have reached its present state of popularity. Introduction of the ball bearing. Among the improvements made to the ordinary high bicycle, the most important was the patenting of the ball bearing. The actual patent was the subject of litigation at a later date, but I believe the credit for the screw adjusting type should be given either to William Bowne of Birmingham or to an engineer named Green of the same city. Previously to the ball bearing, a bicycle had either plain bearings or roller bearings. The former required constant oiling, and the latter were not easily adjustable for wear and entailed a heavier construction than ball bearings. Bowne, then, or Green, brought out a bearing which consisted of a grooved cone and two cups, the grooves in all three being slightly wider in radius than the diameter of the ball. When wear took place, the cups or one cup were screwed inwards and relocked. These were separate proprietary articles and were attached to the fork of a bicycle by cotters and nuts. The rear wheel was provided with a slightly different type of ball bearing, the adjustment being effected by screwing the cones, or one cone, inwards instead of the cup or cups. Subsequently, ball bearings were applied to the steering and the pedals, but an indication of their importance may be gained by the fact that for a long time the manufacturers catalogued their machines with plain bearing pedals and charged 30 shillings extra for ball pedals. We have now arrived at the stage when a high bicycle was regarded as dangerous, and if the front wheel were too small, it detracted from the rider's speed owing to the shorter distance covered by each turn of the wheel. What was the next move? The engineer's mind turned towards a method of gearing by cogs or chains, by which one turn of the crank axle would cause the driven wheel to turn more than once. That is where we get our method of describing the ratio of gearing between the crank and the wheel of a modern safety bicycle. The previous machines had wheels, say, from 50 inches to 60 inches in diameter or height from the ground. Now, supposing you took a 25-inch and a 30-inch wheel, and by means of gearing made them turn twice to each turn of the pedals and cranks, they would be equal to 50-inch and 60-inch wheels without gearing. That is why we still speak of a bicycle with 28-inch wheel being geared up to, say, 56 inches when it travels as far for one turn of the cranks as a wheel of 56 inches does in one revolution. Various devices were tried for rendering the high bicycle safer to ride, but none was commercially successful, except, perhaps, the facile. The facile was introduced primarily to enable the rider to sit further back along the backbone, and instead of the pedals being attached direct to the cranks, the ends of the cranks were connected to levers pivoted on extensions of the fork sides, and having a bearing for attachment of the connecting rod about one-third of the distance along the lever from the pedal end. The rider, therefore, pedalled by pushing the levers down alternately and releasing the pressure at the end of the strokes. The facile was followed at a later date by the geared facile, which was the same design as the facile and had the same lever motion for pedalling, but included a sun and planet gear on the hub. Briefly, this consisted of a large tooth wheel on the axle and a crank extending beyond the edge of the wheel. Working in a bearing on the crank end was a small planet pinion or toothed wheel which meshed with the larger toothed wheel. Pressure on the pedal caused the planet wheel to travel around the larger sun wheel, and the road wheel was geared up to the extent of the added diameter of the planet wheel. Thus, if the planet wheel were 1/4 the size of the sun wheel, it geared up the road wheel of 45 inches to 56¼ inches or thereabouts. Then with a bound came the geared up front driver. The first was the Kangaroo, produced by Hillman, Herbert and Cooper. This machine had wheels of about 36 and 24 inches, the front of 36 inches being driven. To gear up the wheel, the fork blades were extended beyond the centre of the wheel towards the ground and bent slightly backward. At each end was a bearing for a separate crank, and attached to the crankshaft, which ran on a ball bearing and was very short, was a chain wheel. This wheel was slightly larger than a similar wheel on the hub, and the two wheels were connected by a chain. The arrangement was duplicated the other side of the main driven wheel, and, as already explained, owing to the gearing up, the wheel was turned about 1.5 times for one complete turn of the crank axles. Many hundreds were sold, but owing to the short crank bearings and the difficulty in keeping the chains equally adjusted, the vogue was comparatively short-lived. The Kangaroo was followed by the Geared Ordinary and the Bantam, Boothroyd's patents. The first was a dwarf ordinary with a gearing at the front hub, which had the same effect as the chains and sprockets of the Kangaroo, but employed spur wheels with teeth all enclosed in a casing formed by the hub shell. The Bantam had smaller wheels and a similar gearing. Various attempts had been made about 1876-79 to design an absolutely safe bicycle. H.J. Lawson produced a machine in 1876 which was practically equivalent to enlarging the rear wheel of a high bicycle, leaving the front wheel the same size and driving the rear wheel by a lever motion. The lever motion, as distinct from the rotary crank, was the first form of driving medium used on wood four-wheelers prior to the velocipede or bone shaker. Briefly, when brought out on Lawson's rear-driven bicycle, it comprised a crank on each side of the hub and key to the axle, a continuation of the frame carrying a bearing for the foot lever. At a point along the foot lever, varying with the type of machine, was a bearing for a connecting rod which connected the crank on the hub axle to the foot lever in a similar way to the facile already described. The Singer Extraordinary Challenge was another model that was introduced to put the rider further back and down the backbone, and yet to leave him in a position where he could exercise power over the cranks. The machine resembled an ordinary, but had an abnormally raked fork at an angle of nearly 30 degrees. The cranks were driven by levers pivoted to bearings on the fork sides, about halfway between the wheel centre and the periphery. There are various claimants to the credit of introducing the first rear-driven safety bicycle, where the wheels were practically of equal size, and the gearing up of the driven wheel being effected by a pair of chain wheels and a chain. Commercially, and it is the object of this book to show the growth of the industry from a business point of view, the honour is due to the late J.K. Starley, nephew of the original James Starley. Mr. Starley was in partnership with a Mr.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.